What's going on, everybody? It's your boy Kilo Loco, and today we're going to be working with Flutter. So we're in at day 10 of hashtag 30 days of Flutter, and today we're actually going to be working with one of the most important concepts that you're going to come across as a developer, and this is going to be network requests. So in this video, we're actually going to be going over how to make a network request go up to an API and pull down some data. Now, we won't be working too much with Flutter in this tutorial, but I will, you know, since it is hashtag 30 days of Flutter, I'm going to show you how to display the JSON onto the screen just so that we're doing something Flutter related. But this is a core concept that you need to fully understand before we move any further, because we are going to start doing networking requests and building out more relevant apps in the next couple of days. So with all that said, let's go ahead and jump right on in. All right, so as you can see, we're starting off at pub.dev. The package that we're picking up today is HTTP, just like that thing that you put up in that browser bar, right? So go ahead and select HTTP. Now, it's relatively simple to work with HTTP, the package. All you need to do is come up with some URL or a URI. You pass it in, and then you essentially create the request, or you perform the request. Now, this is showing you how to do a post. We're only going to be working with a GET today, just to make it really simple, but I want to make it very informative for you so that you're comfortable working with JSON, understanding how it's structured, and getting that into the app. So let's go up to installing, and we're going to grab that little dependency right there. We're gonna be like, bam, we're gonna head over to pubspec.yaml, and we are going to paste it in under dependencies. We hit save, like bam, and let me just show you what the app looks like right now. So as you can see, all it is just a simple button. You should be comfortable with making buttons at this point. I actually used a widget that we haven't used this far, which is called an elevated button. But other than that, nothing crazy going on right here. We just have a child of text and then on pressed method right here, which is make requests. It's an asynchronous function. I'll show you a little bit more about why it's going to be asynchronous in a bit. So with our new HTTP package all up in our project, let's create a new file called data service. All right, so we have our new data service object, our new data service class, and we're just going to have a single function in here. Now, the reason why we created a separate file and a separate object, a different service, is because generally what you want to do when you're working with different services like HTTP, or you're like trying to do one type of thing while you're programming, you try to clump all that functionality together into objects, or into like these services that we have here. So this is going to be the object that's responsible for going out and getting our data and returning it to us. So that's why I made a separate class. We could really do it in the main.dart if we wanted, but that's just not best practices. So let's go ahead and create a function that's going to be called get or perform request or something like that. So now we have this function called make request to API. Now, just so that you know what API is, it's application program interface. Don't worry about memorizing it. Nobody needs to know what it really stands for, but I want to show you what the API is that we're hitting. All it really means is that we're interacting with some backend server that has information that we can ask for. So we're able to talk and communicate with this backend server, this backend computer, that we can say, hey, can I have some information? And it's going to be like, oh yeah, sure. Kilo sent you. Why not, right? So I have this API, let me go ahead and type it in for you. So you can feel free to go out and Google and check all the different APIs there are, but this one's obviously gonna be the simplest because it doesn't require anything. It's this api.kiloloco.com/users. So this is just an API that I created, and it simply returns back like the members of my family, right, and our ages, and it just gives us a little bit of information here. So as you can see, an API gives you back, it will generally give you back JSON. That's usually what you're going to see APIs give return to you. So it's going to give you back data like this. And as you can see, there's like a pattern to the way that the data is structured, right? We have these square braces right here at the top and at the bottom. You see one's open and one's closed. Now this means that it's kind of like a list, right? It's a list of whatever's in here. So just like in Dart, when you want to use square braces and have like a list of things, like we've had a list of states, a list of, I can't even remember all the different things that we had lists of, but we have a list of things in here. Now these curly braces right here that you can see represent that means that's an object. So we have a list of objects inside of our square braces. Now inside of those curly braces, inside of our object, we have different properties, right? So the properties, you can see we have on the left side, which is a key. From what I know, all APIs return keys as strings. So just keep that in mind, but like, yeah, we have a key and then we have a value. So the key is just gonna be some name. And it's going to say, okay, it's going to separate the value by a colon. So for this object, we can see that we have a key, which is ID, and the value is 1. And then we have a name, which is the key, and then we have a value, which is Kyle. Another key, another value. So then you can see that all of the data is formatted in the same way, right? So each of these objects have an ID, they have a name, and they have an age, right? So all of our data is very consistent, and that's what we're generally looking for when we have an API. Now there are much more advanced APIs and sometimes the data isn't always consistent, but in our example today, it's going to stay consistent. So we don't have to name this object anything specific. We could call it a person, we could call it a human, we could call it a car if you want. I mean, call it poop, I don't care. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to say that we generally have a list of users. We're not going to be creating any objects to encapsulate that data, but I'm just going to refer to this as our list of users. So now what I want to do is I want to retrieve this data and I want to show it in our app. So all I want to do is I want to go up to the internet. I want to hit this API, this URL, right? And I want to get this data back so that I could display it in my app, just as it is, right? So that's what we're going to be doing. Now I want to take this URL because we're going to need it and go back over to our data service. And what I want to do now is I need to create a URI. I actually don't know the difference between a URI and a URL, but you can think about it as just essentially being a URL for the most part. All right, so as you can see, we're going to create a new URI object. We're going to use a constructor called HTTPS, and this takes in two different arguments. It takes in the authority, which is essentially just the host, and we can see the host name right here. It's essentially this part, the base URL for the most part. So it's not the HTTPS, it's not the :// and it's not the end path right here. It's simply this. So we need to pass that in there, and we pass it in there as just a string. So if I do this, what I want to do is I want to remove everything that isn't the base URL. So anything that has a slash, this part can't parse slashes or any of that. So we want it to look like this. Then we need to finish adding in the rest of our URL, right? Which looks like this. So we want to add in the slash users into the unencoded path. So we're going to add that in as a string as well. And we could just say slash users. And that's all we really have to do for this very simple API. We just need to go to this endpoint and then we get our data back. It's as simple as that. We're going to be working with a more advanced API in the next video tomorrow. But for the most part, this is like the core concept of everything that we're going to do. So now that we have our URI, what we want to do is we want to actually go out to the internet and get it. And we do that with HTTP, which is the package that we just installed. So up at the top, what we're going to do is we're going to import HTTP. Now, as you can see, I'm going to do this manually. And the reason why I'm going to do it manually, I mean, you could auto import it, but what we want to do is we want to cast it as, and we give it a name. You could put poop right here if you want, but I'm just going to put HTTP. I don't fully know the reason why they recommend that we do it as HTTP. And if you take a look at the documentation, they do it in there in the example as well. So you'll see at the top that they cast it as HTTP. What it's doing is it's saying that if you want to access HTTP, then you have to specify it as HTTP. So you'll see what I mean right now. So if we do HTTP, and what we're going to do is we're going to do a GET request. That means just simply go to the server, go to the API, and ask for it. Just ask for it. Don't do anything special. Don't put anything in there. Just ask for it. So we're going to do GET URI, like that. And it's as simple as that. And then we'll get a response. Now, if we didn't do this cast up here, then we could technically just do this GET right here, like this. And this would work. I think that the reason why they recommend that you cast it is because like these names can get kind of overloaded and reused in other places, and that's why they do it. So I'm not really entirely sure why, but if I had to guess, that would be the reason. So obviously you don't need to know if I don't need to know, right? Like, just to get started at least. So as you can see, we're gonna have the response, and then also, oh, well, we need to make sure that it's cast, right, as HTTP. So we're gonna get a response. Now the response, when you're doing a networking request, it's just like when you go to a website, right? And you know that, you know, you're obviously watching this on the internet. So you know that when you have a bad connection to the internet, or if your data is just slow, that it takes time for information to get back, right? Like sometimes you load a website and it takes a while before you're actually able to see the website sometimes, right? So that means that we're going to be getting back the value at some later time. And when we're working with values that are going to be received at a later time, we're working with asynchronous tasks, and that means that we're gonna be doing await. So we're gonna mark our function with async. We're gonna await for our response. And then once we get our response, what we're going to do is we're going to have a body on the response. The body is going to be whatever comes back from that networking request. So I actually want to return this body from this function right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to change the return type to future and make sure that it specifies a string, because it's going to be returned as a string. We're going to talk about how to convert it into an object in the next video. And we're simply going to return the response dot body, like that. So now we're going to get back whatever the URL gives us, right? So if I go over to our main.dart and in our make request, we can actually get that response. But first we need to actually get an instance of our networks or our data service. So let's do that first. All right, so we have an instance of our data service right there, and we're going to open this up, and we're going to say final response is equal to the data service, and then we're just going to call make request to API, right? So then we have this response right here. Now we want to display this in our UI. So what I'll do, instead of showing just the elevated button, let's go ahead and refactor this into a builder so that we're able to do an if statement and show some text if we have the response back. All right, so as you can see, we wrapped our elevated button into a builder, like, build it, Bob. And now we're able to do a return statement inside of our builder. So what I wanna do is I actually wanna hang on to the response in a property up here, and we could just make this a variable. This will just be like a string, and we could just call it response, right? Keep things simple. And then if we have a response, then we can show the text. But if we don't have a response, then we won't show the text. All right, and there we go. So now we have this if statement inside of our builder. If response is not equal to null, then we'll show that response inside of a text widget. But if it is equal to null, then we'll show our elevated button. And then all we have to do now is just simply make sure that we're returning our response, or we're setting our property response up here to whatever value is in here. And since we're going to be changing state, we need to let Flutter know about it with set state. All right, and there we go. And I actually added in the await. I had forgotten to do that, because remember, this is an asynchronous function. So we need to wait until we get that response back. And then we're just simply setting our response up above to whatever this response is right here. So now our app is pretty much done. Let's reload it, pull it up onto screen, and let's see if we can actually make the response show up. So we're gonna do make request, And there we go. So now we can actually see the JSON that we saw on the website, like in our browser, on the screen. And we're going to be working with this a lot more in detail in the next video, not with this specific API. This is a little bit too simple, but we're actually going to be working more extensively with JSON, creating objects, and then doing stuff with those objects. So I hope that this was an informative video. This is a very core concept. So if there are any questions that you have about networking requests, make sure that you ask the questions in the comments down below or head over to the Discord. You can find the link to the Discord in the comments down below as well. This is a very important concept, and it's very important that you understand how to make the networking request, what's going on during the networking request, and how to read this data, because it's going to be like, it's going to be a huge part of about how you go about being a developer. So that's going to be it for today. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you learned something new, make sure you subscribe so that you can keep learning new things. And I really appreciate your time. Now go out there and keep coding passionately.